Let us adore him. Merry Christmas! Come on! Merry Christmas! Listen, we're so glad that you're here this evening. We got a great, great service for you. We got great choir, great music, short message. No, we do. We have a short message. But we just want you to sit back and just relax, take it easy. In fact, I just want to say you guys are the smart ones. You came to the second service. The first service was just, it was just so crowded. But we're just glad you're here. I hope you can just sit now, just relax. Anybody still have to do some Christmas shopping? Don't you dare raise your hand. Oh, gosh, you'll be in big trouble. Anybody here for the very first time? Can we see your hands? Hey, let's welcome them. Thank you for coming. We're glad you're here. It's only fitting we begin in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, what an incredible night, Lord. Lord, as we just think, we and hundreds of thousands of believers are celebrating your glorious arrival. Father in heaven, what a great message to share, Lord. So I just pray, Father, that you would bless the people that are here. Lord, that they would sense your presence. Lord, that they would know how much you love them. And Father, just have your way in this place tonight, Lord. Give us ears to hear what you want us to hear. Give us eyes to see, Lord. But my biggest prayer is, Lord, give us hearts. Give us hearts to receive your word and this truth, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, greet each other. I was supposed to tell them to greet each other. Why don't you greet one another? I keep messing up.
Girls, I need somebody to let me know if you're not hearing sound from here. At least that popping. That this thing
went
off. Somebody needs to give me a signal, all right?
What kind of signal? Should we, like, wave at you?
The herald, let's sing it.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. Proclaim
You may be seated.
Abide with us, our Lord, Amen.
Thank you. In Isaiah 9:2, it says, "The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine." This reading is from Ann Voskamp's book, The Greatest Gift. The message of Christmas is that this world's a mess and we can never save ourselves from ourselves, and we need a Messiah, for unto us a child is born. The light never comes how you expect it. It comes as the unlikely and the unexpected, and Christmas whispers that there's always hope. It doesn't matter how dark the dark is, there is always a light. A light can still dawn. It doesn't matter if the world even whispers that there's not a hint that help will come from elsewhere, telling us that nothing's ever going to improve or get better or change. But God favors the darkest places so you can see his light the brightest. And once the light of Christmas shatters your dark, shadows forever flee from your shadow lands. There's no going back and living in the dark. You live now in the impenetrable, safe light of light, and Christmas never ends for you. A Christian never stops living Christmas. Christmas lights you. It's Christmas that dawns in you, and you only really believe in Christmas when you really live it. When you light a dark world and the unexpected places with a brave flame of joy. When you warm the cold, hopeless places with the daring joy that God is with us, God is for us, and God is in us. When we are a wick to light hope in the dark, then you believe in Christmas. When you really believe in Christmas, you believe there's really hope for everyone. And unless you keep passing on that miracle of hope, you live like Christmas is a myth. So light the Christmas candles, light them, and you can see it. With every lit candle, sparks of the dawning, hope catching on everything.
This baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. With every breath I'm singing hallelujah. 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 rescue me. This baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew.
Christmas, everyone. We'd like to invite you for this next segment to go ahead and stand with us and join with the choir as we praise our Savior. Amen. We're going to start with My Lighthouse.
In my failures, you are. light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
To the highest name of all.
Wow. Was that incredible or what? You may be seated.
Wow. Listen, if you haven't guessed what our theme is by now, you're never going to get it. It's the light of the world. And Christmas is definitely known for its lights. And I'm sure as you were making your way here, you spotted some of those houses that had those displays out there. In fact, it's a tradition that goes back to the 16th century with the great reformer Martin Luther. He would gather his children and he would put candles on the tree and he would point to those candles and say, these lights here speak of Jesus Christ, the light of the world. And God, this is what Christmas is all about. God has come. The light has come. In fact, John's gospel shouts this out to us. Many of you are familiar with the text. It's John chapter 8. It's verse 12. It's one of the seven I am statements of Jesus. But it comes right after that scene where this woman is brought before Jesus. They say she's caught in the very act of adultery. You know, it's always, where's the guy? But it's interesting how Jesus basically says, you know, he says, you know, your sins are forgiven. He says, you know, where's your accusers? And they all pass away. And then there's this crowd of religious people. And Jesus says to these people, he says, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. The Savior, the Messiah, that's his word to you and I here this evening. That he is the life that all of us are looking for, the life that we're yearning for. In fact, in another place, he says, I've come that you may have life to the fullest, to the abundance. In fact, John tells us in the beginning of his gospel, there in chapter 1, verse 9, that he was the true light and who gives light to everyone. I like that. He defines it. I'm the true light. There's a lot of false lights out there, but I am the true light. And you'll find this light. And this light is for everyone. Now, what is this light? What is this light? Well, this light, as I've been saying, as the song's been singing, this is the light you and I definitely need. We need this light. In fact, it's interesting. You know the scene in the Bible there in Genesis chapter 1. The first time the word light appears in the Bible. It's there in Genesis 1, verse 3. But it's interesting, the verse before it describes what before the universe was. It says, the earth was formless, empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And this light brought direction. This light brought purpose. This light brought form. Think of that. Where there was formlessness and purposelessness, this light brought beauty and form. And I love there in verse 1 where it says there, God did all of this. He created it. He spoke this. Let there be light. And there was light. He created. In the beginning, God created. That word created there. I love that word because it's the Hebrew word bara. It means to create from nothing. This is the God we serve. This is the God who came among us. But it's sad. You can't even get a couple more chapters. It's just from chapter 1 to chapter 3. And there it is, the bad news. You read of Adam's fall or Adam's bomb, man's sin. Sin entered into this world. And what did it bring? It brought darkness. It produced, again, wars and death and murder, pollution, injustice. The list could just go on and on. But our God there in Genesis 3:15, right in the beginning, it didn't take him by surprise. Right there, he began to speak that he was going to send a redeemer. He was going to send a savior who would save us from our sins. A great light would come. That was the promise. And it would extinguish the darkness, the Bible says. That was his promise. In fact, many of you know this. For the past 3 months now, we've been going through the book of Isaiah. And Isaiah is an incredible book. In fact, many of his prophecies, where, you know, you've heard them this Christmas, you've seen many of these prophecies because he actually prophesied 700 years before the birth of Christ. He spoke of his first coming, and he also spoke of his second coming. In fact, if I have any skeptics here, I would just tell you just to listen, to look at these things, to look at these prophecies, the accuracy of these things. Maybe you'll be familiar with this one, Isaiah 7:14. The Lord himself will give you the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child, and she will give birth to a son, and you will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. God was going to come among us. See, even Isaiah, as he's saying these things and sharing these things, using that term, Emmanuel, God among us, I'm sure that they were just thinking, maybe it's just his presence, just his spirit, not realizing that God himself was going to come again, come among us. In fact, Isaiah 9, you probably got a Christmas card, Isaiah 9:6, it's one of my favorite. It says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. This birth would be like no other. And this son would be given. This son would be given as a gift to all of us. And the government will be upon his shoulders. And I love this. His name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. In fact, I love that last verse that says, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. God's zeal for you and me, for humanity, his love, his great love for us, he will bring this about. And that's what he did. He did do these things. 700 years later, to the very T, a virgin gave birth to a child. And his name was Jesus, Yeshua, the Lord, our salvation. In fact, Matthew, when noting these things, he wrote down, actually, if you're taking note, Matthew 4, verse 12, Matthew actually quotes Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2 to us. Because as the people in Galilee are hearing and receiving the gospel for the very first time, they're seeing miracles. They're hearing Jesus speak of their faith and making it so personal to them that it drew these people in. And Isaiah said this. He said, the people who walk in darkness will see a great light, and those who live in the land of deep darkness, a light will shine. That was God's promise. In the darkness, I'm going to bring a great light. And Christians, this is what we're celebrating. This is the Christmas message. All of us were in this darkness. We were in this emptiness, this void, not knowing our purpose, not knowing our God, not knowing our Creator. In fact, Isaiah, just the chapter before, in chapter 8, he said to God's people, and this is a note, this is something you and I, we live in a country where we hear about Messiah, we hear about God, we hear the gospel over and over again. But I think we are like the people of God. See, the people of God, we've been learning in our studies, these were the chosen people of God. God brought them out of captivity, 400 years in Egypt. He gave them a book of laws. He loved those people. He was so near to those people. He brought them through the wilderness. He brought them into the land. He gave them a temple. But yet, he warned them. He told those people, if you continue going your own way, they will pass through it hard-pressed and hungry. The land, life. That's what he was describing there. They will pass through life hard-pressed and hungry. And it shall happen when they are hungry that they will be enraged and curse their king and their God and look upward. Then they will look to the earth and see the trouble and darkness, the gloom, the anguish, and they will be driven into darkness. That's the sad truth. That's what the people of God were experiencing. Why? Because they didn't want God anymore. Though God seemed so, you know, what happened, what actually happened as you study Israel, they took God for granted and God became a distant second to them. Actually, you could see that he just more or less became like a good luck charm. They only called on him when they needed him. It wasn't from the heart anymore. In fact, God said, he says, you worship me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. And, you know, That's the question. How does that happen? I found myself over and over again. How does a person become distant from God? How does that happen? It happens very easily, right? In the life we live and all the attraction out there, we find those things. And many of these things are good things. The education, the career, the hobbies, the relationships. I say this all the time. Sometimes a good thing can be a bad thing if it's keeping you from the best thing. And this is what happened to Israel. And God warned them. God warned them that when you continue on that path, and those currents are so strong out there today, when you and I get caught up in those currents, that God said to his people there in Isaiah 59, he said, listen, the Lord's arm is not too weak to save you, nor is his ear too deaf to hear you. It's your sin that have cut you off from God. Because of your sins, he has turned away and will not listen anymore. It was our sins that keep us away from him. It was our sins that drew us away. And that light becomes dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. And every year, you get attracted to the light. I know this time of year, I mean, the first service was off the hook. You know, there's this attraction, the songs, the prayers during this time. And we begin to say, you know, we need to make those steps and we need to come back. And that's a good thing. But we don't take him seriously, and our sin draws us further and further away. See, Jesus said it right there in John 3:19. This is what he said. He says, God's light came into the world, but people love darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. Their actions were evil. How does that happen? How does that happen to a people? See, that's the bad news. See, the good news is, this light is here today. And this light is here with arms open up. And what God wants to hear happen to you is where he says there in Isaiah 9:2, the people who walked in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in the land of deep darkness, a light will shine. There's a light here today, the light of Christ. And this light, I'm telling you, if you've never experienced before, it's so loving, it's so kind, it's so forgiving. In fact, God's plan for you and me was to take away our sins. That's why he came. That's why he came into this world, to save us from our sins. In fact, you guys know the account, Joseph, where the angel Gabriel appears to Joseph and says, Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. See, that's what we all needed. We needed to be saved from our sins. See, Israel didn't realize this king that was in their midst. They were looking for a conquering king. They were looking for someone to bring ease into their life and just, you know, make it real easy for them and make them prosperous. But see, that's not what they really needed. And sometimes we find that, you know, we find it out too late in life. We think riches, wealth, that's going to bring us satisfaction. Listen, look at the Rolling Stones. They're still singing that song. I can't get no satisfaction. It doesn't bring peace. It doesn't bring the joy. I mean, one only has to look at Hollywood or Betty Ford Clinic. See, inside, when it talks about that darkness, it talks about that yearning, that void, that direction that, where you have no direction in your life. People are hungering for spirituality. They're hungering for God. Because God created you, and he created you and me in his image, and we have his DNA in us. In fact, in Romans 8:20 says that he created us in such a way, there's this yearning, there's this hungering inside us for something more, something greater. And what it is this light that God has made available to all of us if we'd only look to him and draw near to him. See, God sent his son to take away our sins. I love this. I always share this Christmas card I got many years ago. And it says, if our greatest need had been information, God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need was for forgiveness. So he sent us the Savior. See, that's what Christmas is all about. God giving you and I the greatest gift, his son. You know the verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And whosoever, I love that, whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Listen to this part. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him would be saved. See, he came to save us. He came to give us life, everlasting life. In fact, in John's gospel, I love this. There in John 1:12, he says, but to all who believed in him and accepted him, he gave the right to become the children of God. By simply receiving him, believing in him, this is what Christmas is all about. God came to you and he came to me to save us. We couldn't save ourselves. That's the whole gospel right there. You couldn't save yourself. I couldn't save ourselves. But he willingly came to this earth. Think about that. Not only did he come, but he took on flesh and blood. You know, I love this. I always see it at Christmas time. He became like us so that we could become like him. In fact, he knows everything you're feeling tonight. Maybe you're here tonight and you've experienced rejection. Maybe you've experienced where you've been skipped over and someone else got the job. Someone you trusted very closely. They more or less put a knife in your back. Jesus knows exactly what you're going through. See, this is the incredible thing. The Hebrew writer tells us, we have such a God in heaven now that sympathizes with us, that understands us, what we're going through. But the main thing is he came not only to save you, but to take your hell, to take your punishment, to take your sins. Isaiah 53:5 says, but he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so that we could be whole. He was whipped so that we could be healed. And here's us. All of us like sheep have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He willingly did that for us, for you and for me, so that we would not miss out on eternity. See, this is the gospel story. You know, many of us were going to find gifts under the tree, never realizing that the greatest gift was actually on the tree. The Savior, the Lamb of God, Mary's little lamb who took away the sins of the world. You know, I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. I told you I'd be very short. Have you given your heart to Christ? See, he'll never force himself. This is the thing I loved about our faith and our gospel, Christianity. God never forces himself on you. He is a perfect gentleman. He actually says to us, come now, let's reason together, or let's settle this. Though your sins are like scarlet, I will make them white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, I will make them white as snow. See, that's the Savior. That's our God. In fact, I love Jesus so much. He's speaking to religious people, people that, you know, you would think they got it together. But he said to them in Matthew 11:28, he says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle of heart, and you will find rest for your soul. See, that's the battle that goes on in our soul. You know, I know it, because I remember coming to midnight mass and going to church and just sitting there and just looking, and my heart was just hard. My heart, you know, was just, it was just hardened towards the things of God. But yet God was speaking to me, even though my heart was hard. And that's the message of Christmas. The Christmas story. God came to us. And all it is simply inviting him into your heart. I think Mary's the best example, right? Mary was the one, she's hearing all this stuff from the angel, and she says these simple words, "Let it be to me according to your word." I guess the last thing I just want to say to you is come out of the darkness and come into the light. Because such joy waits you, such peace, such love, such security. Everything that you're yearning for, everything that you're looking for. Especially this peace. You know, it's interesting. Every year, this time of year, this is like my 25th time speaking at Christmas Eve services. And when I study the scene, you hear that first Christmas, these angels are constantly saying, "Fear not, fear not." The word to those that were in attendance was "fear not." And I think this Christmas is no different. I think this fear, the things that are going on in this world, they can overwhelm us. And this brings such fear. But Jesus says, "I will give you peace, peace that surpasses all understanding. Not like the world gives. I will give you my peace." It's real simple. Paul tells us this, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Or actually it's saying, will not be disappointed. And I want you to know, this could be the greatest Christmas you'll ever experience in your life by just saying yes to Jesus. Let me pray. Father in heaven, I just thank you so much for every person here tonight, Lord. How you love them. Father, I pray as your spirit is just moving in this place that there'd be those that will dare just to say, Lord, Lord, I call upon you. Come into my heart. Your promise to us says, whoever comes to you, you will not put away. You will not turn away. That's your promise to whoever who calls upon you tonight. So, Lord, I just pray, bless these people. Lord, I pray this is a great, great Christmas for them. I pray you give them traveling mercies and be with them as they go to their different places and homes. And let the joy of the Lord just fill their hearts. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. Listen, we're going to close with Silent Night. You can put the candles. We got candles there. Thank God they're not lit. So you can just put them up there, and we're going to close with Silent Night. Now, I want to hear you guys sing. Come on.
You sing.
Silent Night, Holy Night. So
Christmas, everyone. God bless you.